Well, I'm Mark Stoddard. I'm with the Compliance and Technical Assistance Program. I'm kind of the counterpart to David Rice, he being the inspector. I'm confidential. We're a little bit different in that I tend to be more multimedia. Yeah, I can go on. I'm going to be a little bit quick, I guess, with this, in that I don't want to bore you with some of the information you've seen already. The Compliance and Technical Assistance, who we are, what we do, we help, and then basically the type of work I do, site visits, phone calls. Basically, the new regulations, which affect everyone with perpetual ethylene machine, record keeping, reporting, and then information you, information you may have seen regarding cleanup in the past. We do site visits at your request in preparation for an upcoming inspection, being prepared, being proactive, that's a good thing, and maybe as a result of an inspection. It's not uncommon to actually receive a call from a dry cleaner or even David Rice after an inspection. And then also maybe to talk about alternatives, pollution prevention, or assessing pollution prevention opportunities. Now, I guess a lot of you are here because of the new regulations. The requirements, you're required to use a detector for basically existing businesses that have a machine that was installed before December 2005. They're required to start using a detector as of July 28th of this year. They're supposed to use that on a monthly basis. Now there is the option of doing that on a weekly or bi-weekly basis, depending on what your schedule requires, whether you're above 140 or under 140. It probably makes sense if once you get used to using the detector, perhaps use it all the time. But you do have that option just monthly. And then this is what the rule requires. Here are some photos of a few examples of detectors that some businesses may end up using. Again, it has to make an audible visual signal at 25 parts per million. And then once you detect something, you've got to take action similar to whether in the past having seen a leak or perhaps detected it by your nose. Okay, again, the same thing, the 24 hours, the 2 working days, the 5 working days once you receive the part. December 25th, that may affect some of you, it may affect none of you in this room. Those who installed a new machine would need to have some people call them, Generation 4, Generation 5, closed loop. You have another system that controls PERC. Okay, keeping the receipts, that's the same as in the past. Writing down a number or a zero on your 12-month rolling total. Logging your purchases and keeping the 12-month rolling total. And there are forms available online as far as the 12-month rolling total. If you have questions on that, even after today, you may call me and work on how to do that 12-month rolling total. Weekly inspections or bi-weekly inspections are dictated by that 12-month rolling total. And basically, once you go above 140, then you're doing weekly inspections. So at that point, again, I hate to say it, but the 12-month rolling total becomes kind of an academic process, just keeping it going. But once above that, you're doing weekly inspections. Dates of discovery. Once you've discovered the leak, on the day of your inspection, you make note of that date and then what action you're taking, whether it's something you're doing yourself within the 24 hours, or noting maybe a call or a work order in place with maybe one of your favorite repair people, if They have the part, they have to order the part. They do, you know, as long as you make that contact within 2 working days, that's fine. Once they bring the part in, you have 5 working days to have it installed. Date, temperature, sensor monitoring, you know, record it weekly. Now that's regardless of your purchase of new seats, as far as being above or below. And then for some machines, where you have a pressure gauge, where you're high and low, you can record in lieu of temperature the high and low pressure on a weekly basis. Again, you need to be aware of what does my machine tell me that my high range is and my low range, and making certain that what you read is within those ranges, and if not, taking action as noted, the same time frames as mentioned earlier. Okay, again, as stated in the video, recording a leak is not a violation. Recording a high temperature is not a violation. Recording a pressure outside the range is not a violation. Not taking corrective action is within the time frames. 24 hours, 2 days, 5 minutes. Okay, many of you might be aware of the initial notification form. If you're adding a machine, taking the machine out. And many of you may not be aware of the new form, notification of compliance status. And there is forms back there in the back table. Essentially, the form has 3 questions that need to be addressed. Are you in a building with a residence, someone who lives in that residential area at least 6 months out of the year? I suspect the likelihood is going to be no for all of you. The other is, if you have a business in the strip mall where you're a tenant and you're leasing space, basically, are there other businesses immediately to you either side of you or surrounding you? The other is, are you in compliance? Most likely you're going to put yes, unless again you're hoping for a visit by David Rice. And again, this is due July 28th of this year or soon. So, keeping a copy, as Dave mentioned, of your manufacturer's specifications and recommendations. And basically, hazardous waste. I'm different from Dave in that I don't strictly focus on air issues. I look at hazardous waste issues. It's very likely that many of you have not received, maybe never, a visit by IDEM or a hazardous waste inspector. And maybe you have, it has occurred in the past, but not frequently now. Generally, most dry cleaners, if not, well, most dry cleaners are what are called conditionally exempt. I'll kind of explain that a little bit later. But basically, similar to the air regulations, maintaining your muck in non-leaking containers so you don't have vapor leaking out. One thing I do suggest is that maybe working with your transporter hauler, maybe the place where it's going, or just maybe storage prior to disposal, is having it weighed so you know kind of what quantity of waste am I generating, as to know whether am I regulated to what that is, to what extent am I what is called conditionally exempt, or am I much larger? And that that volume, or that, well, actually weight, is 220 pounds. That would be basically your muck and essentially your carbon filters. And yes, lint would count. Now, if you have questions about whether you think you may be regulated or not, give me a call. We can kind of deal with that by phone, or I can come out and visit you to kind of go through that process. Even have a form that you can kind of do your own tracking. It's not a form you have to turn in, it's just something that you know, how much am I generating, and am I going to be regulated? More or less, if you have one machine, unless again it's a very badly operated machine, you're not going to be regulated. 2, maybe 3, possibly. Again, it depends on how efficient or inefficient. again, just a still and how this is utilized to kind of reuse your separate and separate covering it. And then a big part of preventing either leaks or releases to the air is just doing, you know, something that makes good business sense is checking for leaks. Adding maybe some parts for routine failures. Maybe it has to be monthly, maybe it is yearly. Much like, you know, changing the oil in your car, making certain that you don't have a problem. If you hate to have a problem in the middle of a load or the middle of a busy day. Maybe looking ahead, you know, checking for wear and tear, and you know, there's nothing that says that you can't preemptively replace a part even before a leak occurs. Again, just what might happen through expansion and contraction of joints. Well, okay, optimizing your performance. Again, as Dave mentioned, draining your filters for at least 24 hours. Cleanup. Again, this is something I mentioned during a presentation. I think we're down in Brown County, I believe. Cleanups. It is of concern to some dry cleaners, maybe all, especially those that have been around for quite a while. There is a voluntary cleanup program. Again, some businesses have gone through a phase one, perhaps phase two, through perhaps a property sale. And then these are the types of sites that are going through cleanup. Gas stations or anything dealing with petroleum, followed by dry cleaning. I don't really have a rhyme or reason as to why that's number three. Other than if a dry cleaner has been around long enough, there may have been older practices in place that may have led to maybe a potential leak or a leakage or a contamination. And then if there is an emergency, this is a still line. And then for information, my name, the website that you can check for manual, new rule forms, anything. Again, feel free on confidential, call me, have me come over, and we'll do whatever I can to help you out. It doesn't mean that I want to answer, but I will talk about common sense stuff, keeping things simple, maybe being organized, maybe having a backup. I usually recommend people have someone else trained so that if they, for whatever reason, they are able to take a vacation, Dave Weiss decides to visit when their backup is in place, they know enough to be able to show Dave the records and take them on a tour of the machine while it's operating. That way, the person that is in the know can feel safe that his backup has enough information to at least get through an inspection. Okay, anything? Questions? Yes.
Yeah, you mentioned something somewhat contrary to the last time that I had done this presentation, the relationship to the wastewater. We were all told that last time we all met at the library, we had the big fight between Paul Smith and Dave Rice and all the guards. And it made very clear that in relationship to considering whether you are a traditionally exempt small quantity generator, that you had to add in your wastewater, regardless if you send it away in the truck, in the drums, or whether you evaporated it, or whatever. Or you say that IDEM now has a new look on that?
I don't believe we have a new look. There is a non-rule policy document on what are called, and I believe it's wastewater evaporators. I believe that's what it's called. And you're right, it was a big fight. Paula Smith and David Vince and Dave Rice, and I believe there was a gentleman, I don't know who the people were with the Office of Land Quality, and it seemed at one point that they were determined that, you know, it was air's responsibility and then it was land's responsibility. It's my understanding at this point with PERC is a listed waste. So if you're hauling it away as a waste, then yes, you would have to count that quantity, that the pounds of that. It's going in the drum to be picked up and taken to some treatment, storage, and disposal facility. It's also my understanding that if you have an evaporator through a carbon system, as prescribed in the non-mobile